I want to come back on two examples. So let me draw a picture. All right, so these are two circles, radius one, an interval, length one, so it's a metric space. It has a universal cover. It doesn't seem like you have to convince yourself that you saw it this morning. And the universal cover is a metric space. And what I want you to check is that it is delta hyperbolic. But believe me, you saw it this morning. So this is just the same example, except that you have to convince yourself that it is the same. Second example is really different. So I take two surfaces, two copies of the same surface, or two different surfaces. Sorry, I started. And I draw a segment. I glue a segment between them. Same thing. So again, it's a metric space. So I put here hyperbolic metric, the standard one. Well, standard. There are several, but by hyperbolic, I mean constant curvature. So the exercise. Is to understand the universal cover. Describe the universal cover. Describe the universal cover topologically, but also as a metric space. And convince yourself that it is a delta hyperbolic for some delta that you may be able to compute. So if you can do this, then you have understood the two first lecture in the morning, and that's fine, right? So you could well do something a bit more sophisticated, is to glue, instead of a line, a cylinder. So I'm not doing connected sum, because I'm not cutting off small ball here, but I just glue a cylinder. Same questions. Okay. You probably don't believe me, but at least the fundamental group of this space you saw this morning. And you have to convince yourself that it's not new for you. So I wanted to show with this example, at least with the second, what is important is to be convinced that the metric spaces we are working on don't have a fixed dimension. Dimension may not be the same everywhere. 2, 1, 2. And the notion of dimension a priori doesn't mean anything on these spaces. On this one, it could mean something, but not on the general space. The next remark that I want to make is about Olga's lecture. So she presented real trees, and most of the example that she showed, except for the simplicial trees, are not locally compact. And this is, for us, it is unfortunate that we are not able to work on non-locally compact spaces, because this one would be a good family of space to study. Anyway, you have a broad picture of metric spaces, various kinds. So let me come, today I will do very elementary proof, nothing compared to yesterday, although it was elementary, only balls and annuli. But I agree it was a bit tricky. So I want to come back to this Bishop-Gromov formula, where we usually put big ball upstairs and small ball downstairs to get upper bound. So yesterday I explained, well, I said that we had a Bishop-Gromov formula for radii satisfying these properties, R and 5, 6 over R, where R was supposed to be big enough. I think the figure was this one. So this doesn't mean anything, but D plus delta, it is important that they come into the story somehow. Well, what I didn't say is, maybe I have said it, that we can replace this by small r just by iterating the 5, 6. So R over 5, 6 R, 5, 6R over 25, 36R, and so on and so forth. And ultimately, you can reach any R. And there is a slight improvement where you can just have this 10 instead of 12. This is nothing. So both radii should be not small measured by this threshold. And this is a problem. So for the two next lectures tomorrow morning by Gilles and tomorrow afternoon by me, we need to extend this to small radii. So that is what I will explain today. How do we do this and on what kind of spaces? So in fact, today I will assume that just R is positive. Small r is positive, and of course, capital R is always greater than small r. And I will show how to obtain a Bishop-Gromov inequality from the other one with these data. So the idea is very simple. We'll make a dilation so that r, which is not zero, will become greater than the threshold. And then we apply the old one. Right? So a simple idea. Except that I have to explain what I mean by dilation and on which kind of space. So this is the first step. I want to talk about Boosman spaces. So the name Boosman has been mentioned many times since the beginning of this school. And he has contributed a lot to the geometry of metric spaces. Let me give a definition. A Boosman space, a metric space, I mean, is a complete as a metric space, geodesic space. So again, by geodesic, I mean that between two points there is a minimizing geodesic, but I also include proper. This is stupid because you can have geodesic spaces which are not proper. And we saw some this morning, of course, so I don't want to mess with the Olga's lecture, so let me add proper here, so locally compact in some sense, whose distance is convex. So we add a new piece of information, the convexity of the distance. What do I mean by convex? Here I need only a very simple version of convexity. So convex means that we work with one parameter, and the parameter will be the parametrization of geodesics. So I start with a point x, and I look at two geodesics starting from the same point, C1 and C2, which are parametrized. So Ci is parametrized by, say, 0, 1. And I will take what sometimes we call normal parametrization. So what do I mean by normal parametrization? If we were on a Riemannian manifold, it would be proportionally to arc length. And so what I mean is that the distance for both of them, so that's why I write Ci of t to Ci of 0 is equal to t times the distance Ci of 1, Ci of 0. So it's the parametrization is proportional to arc length, and the coefficient of proportionality is such that at time 1 we reach the endpoint. So nothing difficult here. Right? And so with this parametrization, I can define convexity. So the space is Boosman is if for any two such geodesic, the map distance from C1 of t to C2 of t is convex. Right. It's a weak version of what we could do, right? It's a weak version, but it's sufficient for what I want to do. So it's not necessary to complicate the situation. It's already quite complicated. Are there questions? So Norbert Acampo told me that if you want to keep the people awakened, you should put mistakes in your lectures to see if they are following. So there will be mistakes. Be careful. Right, so let's go. Let me describe another. So we'll have to use another property, which is the property of extension of the geodesic. By the way, this notion of Boosman space is described also in the book by Cornard, Delzan, and Papadopoulos. So extension of geodesic is nothing but if we have a geodesic segment, we'll assume that we can always extend a little bit to a geodesic segment. So this prevents from having some kind of boundary. If you reach the boundary, you cannot extend, and this is excluded. The notion of boundary, if we are not on the manifold, is quite complicated. So this is a good way to replace it by something else. And I'll pinpoint during the small proof where we use this extension of the geodesic. So our context is a Boosman space proper with this property of extension of geodesic segments. All right. So let me make I need to make a few remarks. Well, one remark, actually. One remark. Two remarks. Well, one remark, one example. So the remark is that on a Boosman space, so it is geodesic, so between any two points there is at least one geodesic, but it is unique. And so the reason is obvious. If between X and Y one has two geodesics which achieve the distance, so we have this picture. So you can parameterize this geodesic correctly, normally. And so the definition of Boosman tells you that this distance, as a function of the parameter t, is convex. But a convex function which vanishes at two points is identically zero, if it's positive, not negative, right? So the geodesic have to be the same here. So this is a easy corollary of the definition. So between any x and y in X Boosman, there is a unique geodesic segment. So there are plenty of examples of these spaces, and you will see more in the next lecture. And well, at least one example, which is it's a bit cheating, but Adamar spaces. So if you look at simply connected manifolds of sectional curvature, of non-positive sectional curvature. It's well known that, and you can compute that actually, it's well known that the distance between two geodesic is a convex function. Extendability of geodesic comes from completeness. Complete, simply connected, Riemannian manifold. So if you assume complete, you can extend the geodesic up to infinity. And the negative curvature, non-positive curvature, gives this convexity. This is actually part of the tool. So we are here. I already said that delta hyperbolicity says that the space is negatively curved in the large. Here we are reinforcing negative curvature, non-positive curvature, by asking for this convexity property. All right? Good. So, are there any questions? Did you eat well? Where is the mistake? So far, I didn't put any, but that will come. Okay, so this definition is quite simple. And the result that I want to show is the following. Okay, so the theorem is that if X is a Boosman metric space, which is delta hyperbolic, and again, let me act to make sure that we are not, that I'm not saying stupid thing, proper. And gamma, a group, well, acting, it's a group that you know, acting properly on X by isometries. So if you don't remember properly, it means that the orbit of a point in each ball is finite. There is no accumulation at finite distance. On XD by isometric, and we ask the quotient to be compact with a diameter bounded by some number, which is called D, and somehow the curvature being bounded below, but we replace the curvature condition by the entropy. So I should mention the measure. For some x and for any x less than h. Then we got the following. So I have to check the numbers. Yeah. The following inequality. So I'll write the equality and then I explain. Is less, okay, let me write the number just for fun. 3/25 fourth d delta capital R of a small r, and this for every small r positive and capital R greater or equal. All right, so it's for fun that I put these numbers, but you could put constants here, constants here. What is important is the general shape, right? And this exponential here where the entropy appears. And there is one thing that you should check is that it is insensitive to omotici. The entropy has the physical dimension of the inverse of a distance. So this with this make square of the inverse of the distance, and this with this and this make square of the inverse of the distance. So this is a quantity which has no dimension in the sense of physics. It's not a distance, it's a distance to power zero. And that's very important in this kind of inequality. The same here. So meters divided by meters is nothing, just a number. Right, so you should not care about this and about this. I should put constants, but it's not simpler to write. The important fact is this one, that we can take any radii. Right. The proof is simple. It is simple. So the proof relies on what has been used by Schoma in our lecture. Packing big balls by small balls. And this packing technique is very useful. And I will try to explain. So this, I've not defined dilation yet. This will come. But this pack, if we have some kind of dilation, some kind of homothesy, I don't know how this quantity behaves. Yes? Ah, yes, good point. We don't need the closure. It's an improvement. Because, okay, so this is the counting measure. So there might be point on the orbit on the closure. So this is just greater than the other one. So we are very happy we have an improvement. And the same here. Right. I think it is useless, but I mean, we wrote the paper like this, so okay, it's fun. Right. So what I was saying, thanks for the question, is that if so, think to this as a metric space. If you have an homothesy, so a dilation, remember that this is a counting measure. How does this behave with respect to dilation? Frankly, I don't know. So we have to relate this to some other quantities that behave very well with respect to dilation, right? And these quantities I will describe now. Sorry, I have to read my notes. So I will give several definitions. So first, R packing of B of XR. So a packing of B of XR is just a set of balls, so a family of balls. So let me draw a picture, it's much better. Not exactly. So here is a packing, I draw a packing. It's a family of balls of radius small r into the big balls, which are disjoint. So disjoint family. Of ball of radius xi small r in included in B of xr. Of course, you can put just one. And this would be useless. What is interesting is this number packing. So I have to get used to this notation. So here we have a point x, and we have two radii. So it's maximal number of balls of radius small r in a packing. That we can fit maximal number of balls of radius small r that we can fit in a balls of radius big r around x. Easy definition. So the packing number appears everywhere in mathematics. Now we have a group acting, so we'll define two other objects which depend on the group. So I'm sorry, it's not tricky, it's just difficult to write. So we'll call a gamma r, so let me call just gamma r, a gamma r packing of B of XR. So again, we take a big ball and put small ball inside, but now only centered at points of the orbit. So Gilles drew several nice pictures this morning of points of an orbit in the space. So this is exactly the same here. So here's a ball of radius R around X. And here are the points of the orbit, gamma x, and so on. So some stays in the ball, some are outside. The ball is open, so on the boundary, it's outside. So I will draw small balls. I should put one more here. Small balls around the point of the orbit, and that will define the gamma r packing of B of xr. So the same as above, but with balls of radius small r centered at point of the orbit and included inside B of XR. Right? So it will pack the big ball, but not optimally because there are fewer points here, right? And we define another quantity. Pack, where to put the gamma? Ah, below. Pack gamma x small r, big R. which is the maximal number of balls of radius r centered at points of the orbit that we can put in the big ball of radius r. Right. So it's a packing number which is adapted to the situation where we have a group acting on the space. And the last one is a covering number. So a gamma r covering. So is a family of ball gamma j x r, small r, j belong to some set of indices. So I have to put one here. So it's again centered at point of the orbit, but not necessarily inside the ball. The thing that I want is that it covers XR intersected with gamma X. In fact, it's included in the union of this ball. Right? Sorry. J, this is small r, J in J. So I want the union of this ball to cover all the points of the orbit which is in a closed ball of radius capital R. Why? You'll see in a minute. Right. So it's a definition, and cover gamma x r r is the minimal number minimal number of such ball, minimal is better here. So if we pack, we look for maximal number. If we cover, we look for minimal number, because we can always add balls, right? So minimal number of balls in a covering, gamma r covering. Okay, so this is a game that we will play. Pack balls into the big ball, or cover the orbit which is on the big ball, but by small balls. Okay, and that's finished. Well, not quite. Right? Do you have any question? These are just definitions that you have to get acquainted with, but it's much simpler than what I did yesterday. Right, so now there is a lemma which is trivial. Yeah? Which ball? They are just disjoint. These balls are disjoint. So they are far apart. Distance is twice r of the centers. Did I answer your question? They are far apart because they are disjoint. Here they are not disjoint, but we are taking the minimal number of such balls. So you're trying to do the best covering with the least amount of balls. Right? Okay, so these are two classical invariants actually. So the lemma is very elementary, and I'm not going to prove it, and so exercise, prove the lemma. It's easy, you just have to play with these balls and where they are, and distances is very elementary. But let me write this lemma rather than talking for hours. So the first one is that cover gamma of x R and capital R is less than pack gamma of X R over 2 R plus R over 2. This is kind of obvious. The second, this is the interesting one. Pack gamma of X R R. This pack is related to the Bishop-Gromov ratio. So it's less than B of XR I have to check the radii because I might be wrong. B of x small r, which is less than mu x gamma b bar, as I said before, because there might be element of the orbits, there might be point of the orbits on the boundary of B that we want to count, mu x gamma b of x small r, which is in turn less than the cover gamma of x r and capital R. And the third one is if there is a compact cushion, so say d, I recall that d is greater than diameter of x divided by gamma, then pack gamma of x r capital R is less than pack of x r capital R, which is less than pack gamma of x. I will explain in a minute. I just write it because it's painful to write. Okay, so these inequalities are very simple. And remember that this is a counting measure, so these are number of points in some balls. So it's related to these notions. It's not completely independent, right? This one, for example, is trivial. Because if you cover your ball of radius capital R by small balls centered, no, if you pack small balls centered at point of the orbits, there might be holes in the big ball. So you can put more inside. That's why there is this inequality.
So
right?
One
what? No, they are two all different.
Yes. What do you write back? Oh, okay.
Pack gamma, pack without gamma, pack gamma with this radius. And I'm sorry. This inequality from this to here is obvious because you reduce the size of small balls, so you can put more. So this is obvious. This is obvious. I leave to you to finish. And the rest is the same. But the point here, which is interesting, is that we can bound from below this Bishop-Gromov ratio by a packing number. And if we can bound from above by, again, a packing number. So this ratio is between two packing numbers. So now I have to explain how we deal with these packing numbers, and we will be done. So this is next step. Do you have any other question? So the exercise is prove the lemma. I'm sure that you can do it. By the way, I give exercise. Before I leave, I would like to see the answer. And I'm leaving on Thursday. So who is writing the answers? Okay, I'll decide myself then. Good. Okay, may I erase this side here? So there is one piece of information that I did not give at the moment, which is this notion of dilation that I mentioned several times. So what is a dilation in the space? What is some homothesy? So let me describe dilations. It's very simple. In fact, I will describe contraction. And you agree that it is the same? Almost. So I take a Boosman space. A number lambda between 0 and 1. Well, 0 is not useful. Right, and I define a map, phi x lambda, for each x and each lambda from x, the space, to itself, which is defined as follows. So x is here. I take a point y. And there is a unique geodesic going from x to y, which I call cy, which I take with a normal parametrization. Cy of 0 is x, cy of y is, of 1, excuse me, is y. So I take a normal parametrization to make sure that things are correct. And so with this lambda, I define phi x lambda of y to be cy of lambda. So lambda is 2/3. You get here. This is cy of 1, and this is cy of 0. So why is it well-defined? It's well-defined because there is a unique geodesic between the two points. So that's where the Boosman condition appears. It's not a dilation, it's a contraction. But later, I will use dilations. And why is it a problem to have a dilation? Well, if I want to dilate, I have to go further. So I have to know that we can extend geodesic. And that is exactly where this hypothesis comes in the story, OK? Good. It turns out that this dilation behaves well with respect to this packing number, or vice versa. The packing number behaves well with respect to the action of the dilation or the contraction. So there is a second lemma, which I will not prove again. Well, is even simpler than the previous one. And the lemma is as follows. It is elementary, really elementary. The distance between phi x lambda of y and phi x lambda of y prime is less than lambda times dy y prime. So this is really a contraction. And consequently, the packing number of the ball centered of x by small ball of radius epsilon of the big ball of radius r is less than the packing number of ball centered at x of a small ball of radius capital R on small r and of a big ball of radius r. Right. Okay, don't worry, I will explain. These numbers are not taken randomly, right? So this is easy. It comes from convexity. So you look at cy of t, cy prime of t, parameterized normally, right? And you look at the distance. They start at the same point, x. So the distance is convex. So you get, so convexity, I have to put, I want to put the, 1 minus lambda. 1 minus lambda distance of cy of 0, cy prime of 0, plus lambda distance of cy 1, cy prime of 1. OK, so the geodesic start at the same point, so this is 0. And here, by definition, it's y and y prime. So it's even less. We don't use the full strength of convexity here, just because we are only looking at geodesic starting from a given point. All right? So this explain this. And how do you explain this? Well, you have to notice that r is equal to r is equal to r divided by small r multiplied by small r. So you see this number here. Let's call it alpha. So what we are doing is a dilation on the two radii. So I draw a picture, and I'll leave to you to finish the proof. Right? So we have several balls. This one, which is of radius r, centered at x. This one, which is a radius small r, centered at x. We pack the small one by balls of radius epsilon. And now you apply the dilation. And you have to check that the ball of radius epsilon are sent on ball of radius this, alpha epsilon. And you have to check that it is a packing, that is a ball are disjoint. This is very easy. So in fact, we are using dilation, so we need the extension of geodesic. You dilate the, picture. Well, there is just a slight, no, that's okay, it's easy. Right? You see that the picture, you can do the proof tonight before dinner. Okay. And this was a, this is a key point. The point where we have a relationship between this packing number and the dilation. And this packing number are related to the Bishop-Gromov ratio. So we should be finished. And in fact, it is finished. I will write a sequence of inequalities which come from the first lemma. And we are done. Let me make one remark. Yesterday, I said that the theorem with the big radii was valid also for any invariant measure, reasonable invariant measure. This one with all radii, even the small one, is not true for any invariant measure. So we do have counterexample. So it's really because the measure is a counting measure that works. But this is sufficient for our purpose. Right. So I want to study this. So sorry, I will write some inequality, but it will take. If you don't like inequalities, just do the exercise in the meantime. So we had in the list that I had written before, we had one which was cover gamma x. So what is it? Small r, capital R. And this cover gamma was less than pack gamma x r over 2 capital R plus r over 2. Right. So far we did nothing. And this pack gamma is less than pack without gamma of the same radii. Just because if you put balls centered on the orbit, they are less balls than putting everywhere. So these are inequalities that I have a combination of the inequalities 1, 2, 3 before. In fact, 1 and 2 only. Right? And now I want to use here, right? Because of that, I want to use here the dilation. So this is less than, okay. So let me, okay. This is less again, so it comes like this. This is less than x alpha r over 2, alpha r plus r over 2, for any alpha which is greater or equal to 1. And this is the dilation by alpha, right? What's next? And we finish by the fact that there is a compact quotient which allows us to reduce a little bit this this quantity here, right? And so let me check, because I have a doubt, and I doubt what I have written, but I think it's correct. I'm just anxious. Okay, perfect. Well, if one can say so, right? Then the next thing is that since we have a compact quotient, we can reduce a little bit this, and we get back of x, so alpha r over 2 minus capital D, and alpha r plus r over 2. Right. Or maybe I should, yeah, exactly. So this is the first lemma. So this is the dilation. This is again the first lemma, the third part. And now we apply the first lemma, the fourth part, which gives mu x gamma b bar of x alpha a plus small a over 2, mu x gamma b of x alpha a over 2 minus d. Right. And we are done if we can choose alpha so that these two numbers are greater or equal or greater than the threshold that we had yesterday. Right. So in fact, we can take any alpha. So we choose alpha so that alpha r over 2 minus d equals 10 times d plus 2 delta. So this is choice of alpha. Right? Okay. And you can check that alpha, the second one, r plus r over 2 is greater than this one. So it's greater than 10 times d plus 2 delta. So this gives a value for alpha depending only on small r, d, and delta. These two inequalities, this one is an inequality, doesn't change, tells us that we can apply the previous formula. So you apply the previous formula, and you get something which is such that when you replace alpha by its value, you get the inequality that I wrote at the beginning. So let me not do the computation at this stage. So there is a formula here that I gave it the first day, the very first day at the end. So we can apply it because these two quantities are greater than the threshold. And then you just replace alpha by its value, and you get a reasonable formula. OK, as you can see, it's completely elementary. So maybe you don't want to retain, you don't want to keep in mind the proof, but you should keep in mind the ideas. So working on Boosman spaces with extendable geodesic, so we have contraction and dilation, and this Bishop-Gromov ratio is related to this packing number, which is an important number in mathematics. Right, so I'll finish, I'm almost done. So if I have time, I say something else. So there is something that we Gilles and I will need. So I will state it. If I can, if you agree, I can erase. Right, and the last lemma. The last lemma. So I call it corollary. It's not really a corollary of the theorem. It's a corollary of this statement lemma where there were these packing and covers and so on. So if gamma prime included in gamma is a subgroup of gamma, then for every x, every r, so greater than zero and r, I'm sorry, and capital R greater than r, we have that the counting measure p bar of x r measure b of x small r, this time with a small group. So if it's a subgroup, the orbit is less. So we reduce the numerator, but we also reduce the denominator. So a priori, we don't know how this behaves with respect to the other ratio. The other ratio. And in fact, if we enlarge a little bit the numerator and reduce a little bit the denominator, not a little bit, divide by 2, then we get an inequality. So the Bishop-Gromov ratio on a subgroup can be controlled by the Bishop-Gromov ratio of the full group. Right. Yes. Even if the group gamma prime is reduced to the identity, you get one here and whatever on the other side. So it's completely general, and the proof is one line, and I will write for you this line. Sorry, to write again the same, always the same thing. X small r. So this is less than cover gamma prime. So that's what we have proved, which is less than pack gamma prime x r over 2 r plus r over 2, which is less than pack gamma x r over 2 r over 2 r plus r over 2. And this is less than mu x gamma v bar of x r plus r over 2 and mu x gamma b of x r over 2. Okay. So let me explain. So I've written one line as promised. So this is one of the inequality in the lemma. This is another inequality in the lemma. And this is also one equality in the lemma. And the only new part is here where we change the group. Okay. But here, the orbit is smaller. So if I represent x, and I represent gamma prime 1 of x, gamma prime 2 of x, this is the orbit of the small group. And we want to put balls on it so that they are disjoint. Well, when you look at the orbit of the large group, there might be more elements. So there are more balls here to be put. So this inequality is trivial. So I would say easy, trivial, trivial, easy. Right. So this is very useful. And so Gilles will probably use it tomorrow morning, and I will use it tomorrow afternoon. And I said all what I wanted for today, but I will not stop. I will come back on this quickly on this entropy story, because I did not prepare anything else. And now the lecture between Gilles and I are following each other, so we have to decide in advance, right? So I let you note this for tonight. I leave this on the board. So let me say a few words about this entropy on manifolds. In fact, there is several notions on entropy on Riemannian manifolds. So this one is usually called, well, we called it volume entropy, because we use volume. And so I recall the definition. We start with I usually start with a closed, compact Riemannian manifold. And the metric space that we'll be looking at is the universal cover, which has an induced metric just by pullback. So it's a Riemannian space, but we can look at the distance also. And so if you pick a point, we can look at the volume of the ball centered at this point and of radius r. So the volume now is computed by the standard metric, the standard volume element that is usually written like this, TVG, V for volume and G for metric, and was used extensively by Soma in our lecture. We do the same thing. So as I said, the idea in general is that this, if we are in negative curvature, grows exponentially. So it's like exponential times a constant time, exponential of a constant times r, and we want to compute the constant. So you take logarithm, divide by r, and take the limit. B because of the compact quotient, there is a limit, and it's obvious in general that it does not depend on X, right? So we usually call it entropy. So by abuse of language, we call it entropy of MG, but we could call it entropy of the universal cover. Anyway, I'm talking about a Riemannian manifold. Could be Finsler manifold. Could be even non-symmetric Finsler. And if there is no compact quotient, maybe this is not a limit, but you could take Lyman. Right, so it's a very strong invariant. It's called entropy because it's related to the entropy of a dynamical system. So entropy is a notion in physics. And there is a natural dynamical system on a compact manifold, maybe you know it, which is called the geodesic flow. But the geodesic flow is not acting on the manifold itself, but on the space of unit vectors. So I don't want to describe this because it would bring us too far. But as soon as you have a dynamical system, you are in a physical system, and then you can define all kinds of entropies. And this one is, in some cases, it is related or equal, actually, topological, so-called topological entropy of the geodesic flow. Whatever. The definition are much more complicated for dynamical system. Here it's very simple. You compute volume of balls, and Schumann explained that when you have a Bishop inequality, not a Bishop Gromov, the simplest one with one volume of ball, then you can get estimates of it. Okay, so maybe, what can I say? Okay, so to show the strength of this, I may mention a result that with Gilles and Gallo we obtained 25 years ago. Okay, so let me state it in a weak form. And this shows how strong is this invariant. So it's an asymptotic invariant, and it does not seem to be very interesting, but in fact, it is very strong. And that's what we want to show in working with these metric spaces. So the result that we obtain, so let me mention my collaborators. So Courtois, Gallo, who are still my collaborators. And so the paper was published, I don't remember, 1995. So you start with a compact manifold without boundary. Compact without boundary, we call it closed, with a hyperbolic, locally hyperbolic metric. Right? So locally hyperbolic metric, I mean the curvature is constant equal to minus one. And now, so the entropy of the universal cover is a simply connected hyperbolic metric, and we can compute everything. So the entropy is n minus 1 if n is the dimension of the space. Right, and so, as I said before, because of this R here, the logarithm kills everything if you have square meters here, it kills everything. So because of this R here, the entropy behaves like the inverse of a distance. So we have to normalize it. And the way we normalized it was by the volume. So now if you take any other metric, we look at the following quantity. So take this entropy and multiply by a quantity which is like a distance. So this is inverse of a distance. This is like a distance. So if you do dilation, that will not change. So the quantity is the volume of the manifold. You can compute the volume with this metric to the power 1 over n. And what we showed is that the minimal value of this quantity that we call the minimal entropy is achieved for the hyperbolic metric. So this is right of m g0 1 over n. So this beautiful metric, which is symmetric, achieves the minimum of this quantity. And more than that is equality implies isometry. Isometric. So there is only one minimum to this functional. So you can see a functional space of metric. There is only one minimum. And this minimum is achieved at the most beautiful metric in this space, which is the I double equal. Right? So with only one invariant, we can characterize this. So by the way, the corollary of this is a new proof of most rigidity theorem, much simpler than the original proof, because you asked me the question. Right? And so that started us to study entropy as a replacement to curvature, and even to integral of curvatures. And that's why we came to this story about metric spaces. Right. So I promised to say something. This, okay, for that. So now in the Finslayer situation, there in general there are very few compact collisions, but on Hilbert metrics you could look at the entropy and try to find inequalities. So there are results in this direction. So we mentioned some of these results to the people who are interested, and there is a lot to do. Okay, so thank you very much. I stop here.